In this video lecture, we're going to talk about some more of the technical overview details of Java before we start digging into the language itself. Okay, let's get started. If you were to read through some marketing material or a technical overview of Java, you'd find these types of things in a list of its capabilities. The Java syntax is very much similar to C or C++. So if you're familiar with either one of those languages, Java will seem very familiar. It's probably safe to say that this resemblance was intended to help make the transition to Java from these other languages more palatable. Java is inherently object-oriented. No surprise there. We've already been talking about Java in terms of object-oriented programming. As we said previously, Java arose near the dawn of the Internet era, and so was originally designed with Internet connectivity in mind. As part of the language, Java provides a very rich collection of pre-built classes for development use. I want to say there are around 2,000 plus classes as part of the Java language, but I think it's in that ballpark. These classes provide pre-built capability for such things as user interface building, database connection, networking, and many other features. The Java language is extremely well documented online via the Java API, which is a hyperlinked collection of all available Java classes and their documentation. After having to learn my first languages through textbooks and manuals and word of mouth, I remember how amazed and delighted I was to find that everything I needed to know about Java was well documented online as part of the language. We'll take a look at the Java API in future lecture segments. By the way, API stands for Application Programming Interface. Finally, one of the huge selling points about Java is that it is portable across multiple computing platforms. We'll take a look at what this means a few slides from now. Although we won't be concerned with these distinctions in this course, there are three different Java program types. Java applets are small client-side programs which can add interactive features to websites. When we view an HTML web page with an applet embedded in it, that applet is executed locally on the client machine by its browser. Java servlets, by contrast, are run on the web server side, typically to generate some sort of web content. Java applications, which will be the focus of our efforts in this course, are standalone programs which will run on our own individual development machines using the GRASPIDE IDE. So here we just want to let you know that these other Java program types exist. As we said earlier, Java is a hybrid language, which means it's partially compiled and partially interpreted. Once you've written some Java code in a Java file, the Java compiler turns that source code into bytecode, which is a binary, machine-portable set of instructions which can be run on any platform. If you want to, you can think of bytecode as your program's executable, although that's not quite a perfect analogy. Then to execute this bytecode, the Java Virtual Machine, or JVM, interprets those bytecodes at runtime and converts them into machine language, ones and zeros, that can run on that particular platform's CPU. Think of the JVM as being a Java simulator which runs that compiled bytecode. When you install the Java JDK or JRE, you get a JVM which is specific to that particular platform. So the JVM itself is platform specific. However, the compiled bytecode is truly platform independent, which means it can run on top of any installed JVM. All this might seem a bit confusing as described here, so let's take a look at a couple of pictures to clear all this up. Here's another look at the layered computer model. Remember that when we looked at models, we said in this course we'd be operating mostly at this green application layer. So here on the right, we see that application layer expanded a bit. Notice that the JVM itself is just one of many applications running on top of the operating system. The JVM is platform specific, which means that there are different JVMs, each specific to one operating system, but Java isolates that platform dependence to the JVM. Any Java application that's been compiled into bytecode or a .class file is interpreted at runtime and executed on top of the JVM. But the JVM isolates any platform dependence such that this same bytecode can be run on any operating system or platform. This is what makes Java applications platform independent and is really one of the strong points of Java. Here's another look at the Java compilation and execution process and how it leads to platform independence. At the top, we see some Java source code in a .java file that's compiled into bytecode or a .class file. That same bytecode can be run on the JVM for any platform, be it Windows, Linux, Mac, or any other operating system. We haven't done away with platform dependence, but instead we've isolated it into each different JVM, so it's only a one-time installation cost. This diagram shows how Java achieves its promise of write once, run anywhere, and that's really huge. It means that software developers can write an application once and be assured that that same code in the form of compiled bytecode will run equivalently on any platform. That's a huge savings in software development efficiency. Finally, I want to say a few words about the Java compiler that still lives under the hood. We are using the GRASPIDE IDE in this course to develop, compile, and execute our code. As you may have noticed already in the JGRASP message window, when we compile our code, we're using the Java C compiler to turn source code into bytecode, and then the Java executable to run that bytecode. Both Java C and Java are simply JDK installed executables, and while these steps take place under the hood, they are echoed to the message window as shown here in the green text. Assuming that our search paths and environment variables are set properly, we could perform the same steps, compilation and execution, manually at the operating system command line as shown here at the bottom. So even though these details are hidden away from us when we use an IDE such as JGRASP, I just want to remind you that these low-level operations are still taking place, even if we don't notice them. All right, that ends this lecture segment. We'll continue next by beginning to dig into the Java language itself.